last speaker for this panel is Gail Osherenko, who is project scientist and lecturer at the Marine Science Institute, Bren School of Environmental Science and Management at UC Santa Barbara.
Thank you, Dave. My profound appreciation to so many speakers that have come before me because they've set the stage to make my job a lot easier to cover what I want to do. And my job today is to talk about place-based management, marine management for California. I'm going to talk a little bit about threats and challenges, most of which have already been covered, tell you what I think of as the roots of the problem, describe where we are today, and what I think is the way forward. I did want to stop just momentarily to be sure everybody really had a good visual of what we're talking about when we talk about sea level rise. The one area that has taken this on in California is the San Francisco Bay area, because they are the area that will suffer the most intensely and has the biggest problem. And so they are moving forward through the Bay Area Conservation and Development Commission. And this is just one of the maps I pulled off of the web. In the blue, you can see what sea level rise is likely to look like at the end of this century. That's about 1.4 meters of sea level rise. And it gives you some idea of what, you know, how seriously we have to take these threats. Competition for ocean space. In the top picture, you're seeing an area of Carpinteria where we have a seal rookery, a harbor seal rookery. Hopefully most of you have come up and seen it, and it's co-located with some oil and gas facilities. Quite recently, the voters of Carpinteria turned away an onshore slant drill project to drill out into the ocean from on land, but it was soundly rejected by the voters. These are just some of the kinds of problems that we are facing. And then the two things I really want to focus on are aquaculture, which is coming in fast because we import 84% of the food we eat from the sea. And half of that probably is from aquaculture. We produce very little, and recently the Department of Commerce and NOAA has issued a new policy to govern and encourage more aquaculture off our shores. And I don't know what people here feel about that, but I think it's a reality that we will be asked to make space. The policy says it encourages and anticipates growth of, quote, environmentally sound and sustainable domestic aquaculture. Currently, we have pretty small facilities. I was going to say the aquapod in the lower corner is typical of an offshore, that's a company from Maine, I think, and it's typical of what they want to use under the water. They drop them under 3 to 5 meters. They need 45 or more feet of depth. They come in several sizes. The Bren School students have done a recent project looking at trying to identify the best sites off of La Paz in the Gulf of California in Mexico for both profitability and environmental sustainability of placement of some of these. So this is a technology that's coming very fast. They're in use in the East Coast for finfish aquaculture. And then we have hydrokinetic energy, which people have also talked about. And I mostly wanted to put up just a few pictures of what different technologies look like. The one you've probably all seen is the snake form in the upper right-hand column in use in the UK. Basically, the message is these are big industrial facilities. They will take up a lot of ocean space. And they're not very compatible with most other uses. The stage we're at now is really to try to identify some locations where we can test these technologies. There are 30 or 40, I think, patented technologies of various different kinds. We don't know which will work best, under which conditions, and which will be profitable. But we do need to get them in the water if we're serious about making a transition from fossil fuel. So this is basically what's coming at us and what we need to make space for. There is one major proposal off of Vandenberg Air Force Base in Santa Barbara County. That's what they call a plug and power facility. And the idea is that PG&E sets up the transmission lines and the connection, but it's will be available, and they will choose several of the most promising technologies to test there. They have a license from FERC for this testing, 3 years of testing, and the space that they are allocated is 10 to 15 square miles, which they say they will expect to cut dramatically, maybe 5 to 10 square miles, as they actually hone in on which technologies. But that gives you some idea. There's also a proposal I don't know very much about, and I've asked some people here, and they didn't know a lot about it, but recently announced in the newspapers is a proposal off of San Onofre, and that's obviously raised some questions, and Surfrider has weighed in on it. So I want to talk just very briefly about the roots of the problem, and the real root is societal values and what we value most, and we tend to value short-term economic development and growth over human well-being, quality of life, sustainability of ecosystems over time. And we need to think about what really do we value. This is my friend Tucker and my friends Tucker and Heidi. It's also an example of spatial planning. This is a beach called Hendry's Beach in Santa Barbara. Some of you may know it. And on the one side of the Arroyo Borough, of where the Arroyo comes out, is dogs on leashes, and the other side is dogs off leashes. And it's quite a happy situation, and this dog is quite happy about it. Governance reflects our societal values. So our governance systems really are reflections of what we do value. And unfortunately, our system has grown, especially in California, where growth of population and industry has been very rapid. We've grown sector by sector. And for the most part, we began in the 70s, late 60s, to do environmental assessment. We knew something about cumulative impact, but we really weren't doing ecosystem-based thinking. And so hopefully we will begin to do much more of that as we move forward. This is one of the papers that our NCS group that Elliot talked about produced, and a lot of my thinking today is really embodied in that paper, which I'm not going to go over in detail. I just wanted you to know it exists. It's from May 2007 issue of Environment Magazine. And the basic message is that our current apparatus for managing marine areas, that our oceans are a complex, interconnected, heterogeneous, and dynamic system, and it's a system that's prone to nonlinear and even abrupt change. The black line is the state line, 3 nautical miles from shore, and so this was the base planning area for the MLPA process in Southern California. And then this first layer
then
shows
you,
we
have
desalination facilities,
of
the oil and gas leases. And if the map went a little farther to the north, you'd see a lot more of the leases in green and the oil platforms. And then let's look at coastal energy. Suddenly we have a lot of activity, and much of it is on the coast. These are the commercial rockfish conservation areas, and they are ways of managed largely by Department of Fish and Game. These basically cover the trawl and non-trawl fish closures. And then we come to the marine terrestrial mapped areas. I think the important one on this map is in turquoise. That's the Channel Islands National Marine Sanctuary. We also have areas of ecological significance identified in pink, but we can go forward. And this is the first set of marine protected areas done for California, the first one that was really a network of marine protected areas. Red, the areas that are fully protected, marine reserve, no-take zones, and then some smaller areas where some fishing is allowed with specifications about gear type and depth and so on. And then this is the current marine protected areas. This is the process that just was completed for the South Coast and is close to completion for the entire state of California. And you see in the sort of shocking orange the MPAs. They didn't change, I don't think, or not much for the Santa Barbara Channel area, but then we added areas along the coastline. There are two hot pink ones down around San Clemente that are also protected although they're part of a military network, but they're actually, I think, ecological protection zones. And then we have a whole system for leasing areas for aquaculture, mariculture, and kelp harvesting. And I'm not so familiar with this particular management system. There's a very small in purple one up north of Santa Barbara that is for raising mussels. We raise both mussels and pink abalone. But the other areas are demarcated as to what's closed, not available, what's open, and what is they call leasable. And then we get to another set of rockfish conservation areas. The two areas in the green dotted lines are called cowcod conservation areas created in 2001, and they're close to all commercial and recreational fishing for ground fish.
And the rest is
all covered with some closures, and that's really a large-scale area that extends throughout the entire West Coast, including Oregon and Washington. And its boundaries vary at different times. They're to minimize incidental take of overfished rockfish when they're likely to co-occur with other groundfish that would otherwise be fishable. So as you can see, the spatial zonal patterns we have are many, multiple. They go into federal waters. They go into state waters. But they came about it very sectorally, different agencies managing different ones. And then this is the restricted areas from the Department of Defense for a whole range of things, military live fire areas, small arms range, underwater detonations, military and non-military safe harbors, and then there are a couple that are non-military, but they're demarcating areas that are unsafe to go in because of piers or wharfs or something underneath. And then I just want to show you what it looks like if you put it all together. So it's not that we don't have place-based management. We just don't have a coherent, well-thought-out, jointly planned management system. And somehow we need to go from this to something that is more coherent. And there are two things that are really driving that process. One is the competition for a lot of new uses. That on the East Coast, the need for separating dredging zones from areas where people shouldn't go because of the whales, from wind energy, really drove Massachusetts to begin marine spatial planning, and they're considerably ahead of us in some respects in doing sort of multiple use spatial plans. And Rhode Island is following, Delaware is following. This is not, just that we're isolated out here. We, on the other hand, have done a remarkable job with our marine protected areas. The other thing that's driving this is the incredible work that people like Colin Ebert and others are doing in devising spatial tools that allow us to see the oceans. They used to be very opaque. We didn't know what was there. Now we can map the bottom. We can map all the uses. And we can put all this data together, and all these disparate agencies can actually work, or hopefully will in time if we spend the money, work off the same set of maps and data. And Brian Baird is going to take it under his wing to somehow collectively do a much better job at this interagency coordination. At least that's what I'm hoping. So where are we today? As I said, place-based management is not new to California. And another really important thing to notice is the Coastal Zone Management Act got us in the business of place-based management. It said, thou shalt have, a coastal act, and you shall have a set of rules that follow federal policies and federal rules, and we will certify you to do that. And once you're certified, once you have an approved coastal management plan, you not only can manage an area called the coastal zone, which you get to map. Ours is quite big. Ours goes in as deep as 5 miles in some places, like the Santa Monica Mountains, but it's only a few hundred feet from the coast, from the ocean, in a number of other places. Nevertheless, it's a coastal zone. It's a place. and the Coastal Commission has jurisdiction over all development activities that take place there. So it's not as though we don't have a body that really has this great wealth of information and can balance issues and one against the other. What we don't have is we don't have coherent plans. And we've never let our Coastal Commission do the planning exercise, and we've never funded them well. On the other hand, their jurisdiction not only goes to the coastal zone, it goes to all federal activities and all federal licenses and permits that extend anywhere beyond the coastal zone if it affects the coastal zone. So it's a very powerful tool. It's going to be, I suspect, a very powerful part of our implementation, monitoring, and enforcement of whatever we come up with in the way of marine spatial planning. And then I just want to say a word about the Marine Life Protection Act, which we're going to learn more about from another speaker, which we've talked about. I see the MPAs as having created the first two zones in a marine spatial plan that really should only have about four, maybe five zones. That's what we've learned from Great Barrier Reef. You can, that we now have for California waters, not for federal waters, the most restrictive zone, we can go there with our boats, but you can't take anything out of there. So it's a very restrictive zone. And then we have these marine conservation areas and marine parks, which are a little less restricted. So what we need is to define and declare much of the rest of it, the open area in which people can propose new things, and then perhaps another zone or two that activities can take place under something more like a conditional use permit. We may want in California and on the West Coast to begin to really address our urgent and important problem. I don't like to suggest more sectoral management, but we can do it now in a very comprehensive thinking sort of way. We do really need to identify the places where these wave energy facilities can go, or a few places where they can go, and say, let's not go all over the place, because these are big and they conflict with a lot of other stuff. I think the environmental groups, and I chair the board of one of them, is very enthusiastic about these things going forward, but also wants to be sure that the first ones that go through meeting all of the criteria and all the regulations that will really protect the environment, and that they, you know, not interfere. The site in Vandenberg may work out. We don't know. We're looking at it. But let's not spread these things all over the place. Let's get into a different kind of process. And I think I have one last slide. So the take-home message is there's a need for anticipatory governance in contrast to the reactive mode. I don't think we've said this yet, although Elliot might have this morning. We really can make progress without drastic restructuring of existing rights, rules, and regulations. We will make use of everything already in place, and hopefully we will gradually restructure it into a more coherent whole. But we're not going to throw the baby out with the bathwater. We're just trying to make the whole process more coherent and make it less expensive for the environmental groups that have to be in a reactive mode to fight everything that comes along, make it less expensive for those activities we do want to take place to bring proposals forward and get a faster and more efficient process for getting them in the water. I think we need to do it with a federal partnership. I think what I've heard today is the West Coast Governor's Agreement is a good umbrella to do it under. It's where there's likely to be some money. And hopefully our private investor partners will come along and help to further the process, because the federal government and the state governments don't have too much right now. And then we need a very inclusive and equitable shareholder process. I think we have a good example in what happened with the Marine Life Protection Act, but we also have all the lessons we learned from that, and they are multiple. I've had lots of students who participated in helping with elements of that, and it's not a perfect process, but we've learned a lot along the way, and we have a lot to build on. Thank you.
Excellent job, all the speakers. Now I'm going to make everyone feel uncomfortable by asking the speakers to come up here so that they can field questions from the audience. And as the moderator, I'm going to ask the privilege of the chair, as it were, to ask the first question of all of you to respond to from me. You've all talked about common urgent threats and what agencies, courts at local, state, federal levels are doing. And we've heard a lot today in this panel about marine spatial planning, the need to overcome fragmentation, and the need for place-based management. Those of us who've worked in environmental policy and natural resource policy and other areas, I think, know that there's been some experiences with place-based management and its problems. So my question to all four of you is, given your experience in this area, are there models in other, perhaps, environmental or resource areas, compacts, intergovernmental commissions, cooperative agreements that might overcome some of these fragmentations, that might inhibit the need for litigation? Just have at it. Anyone who wants to go first.
Yeah, there are numerous models, and there are models from both private land regulation and public lands regulation, as well as marine and coastal management. So just to give you an idea, there's everything from things like joint powers agreements that we enjoy here in Southern California with SCORP, which is a consortium of water quality regulators and water dischargers in the Southern California Bight, who work together on the umbrella under the umbrella of a joint powers agreement, and together are managing water discharges and water quality in the Southern California Bight. What's exciting about that is that organization is able to push the envelope on the science and on regulation at once. They're developing ecosystem indicators for the Southern California Bight and are able to essentially convince both the discharge community and the water quality regulators at the same time that moving the target forward together is more effective and efficient than fighting each other all the time. On public lands, we've managed our public lands for eons under the Bureau of Land Management, under the Department of Agriculture, with the Forest Service. We, right now, our group at the Center for Ocean Solutions is working on a lessons learned project from public lands management, and there are many things to take up from that. The use of the entrainment of science, the use of health indicators for ecosystems, and how you actually build those into a more dynamic system so that as your science and knowledge changes, you're able to apply it more readily and not get stuck in old ways. And how to manage multiple uses in singular geographies. So I think there is, you know, I think this is a quote I tried to get Brian Baird to use, which is, there's a lot of old wine that we can put in new bottles. And we shouldn't hesitate to learn from our past experiences. I think we have a tendency to want the new and the novel and get attracted to that. But I think that there's a lot of knitting that still needs to be done on old problems and finishing up unfinished business and learning from things that are being have been, you know, used, approaches that have been used for decades. So it's a great question.
Thank you. I want to take this moment to partly thank you all for coming. I really do appreciate it. My question is related to, it's the other side of the coin, I think, that was asked earlier. That conventional zoning, when I think of marine spatial planning, I think, first of all, conventional zoning is premised and heavily reliant on stasis, and setting aside or designating areas for particular purposes. It provides certainty. And for ecological areas, we usually designate areas for particular ecological constituents, right? So the problem is, of course, we know these areas are dynamic, right? As climatic conditions change, particularly with anthropogenic climate change, we know that at least some of these areas will become incompatible with at least some of the ecological constituents that are there now, and that, of course, species ranges are going to change. So my question is, how can marine spatial planning integrate or accommodate such fundamental changes, but also avoid being challenged as moving the goalposts somehow arbitrarily? I mean, I realize it's a big question, but it's one that I wrestle with, so I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
I can start. I don't want to monopolize, but one of the great slides that we saw was one of the last slides that Colin showed, which was taking in the cumulative impact assessment that Ben Halpern and his co-authors did for the California Current, and that reflected the impact of human activities on both on the land and in the water and on the water and around it on our coastal and ocean ecosystems. And it looked at the relative vulnerability of our coastal and marine ecosystems to particular human activities and the impacts flowing from them. And it assumed artificially that they are all additive. And I think we have a lot of learning to do about how our human activities are collectively impacting different segments of the ecosystem in combination with the dynamic features of the ocean and the coastal ecosystems, because they are super dynamic, they're super heterogeneous. This patchiness makes it both exciting and it allows these systems to be super productive too. And the changes that you're foretelling that are afoot with climate change, we are getting pretty good projections about how species are going to shift, what's going to happen with sea level rise. We're trying to actually figure out where we're going to be finding hypoxic zones, dead zones along our coast. They're starting to show up. We're trying to learn how to predict those. So we're trying to understand that heterogeneity and the patchiness and how we can model it for the future. And this question of the dynamism of the system, I think, poses the greatest challenge to those of us who are working on the governance structure. Because you're right, we're used to pretty static systems. And to move ourselves to a slightly different mode, and we do this on land with land use a lot. We talk about, you know, a desirable state is, well, level of service C for our traffic, you know, or stuff. And when we hit level of service D or F, we start making adjustments. But they're all reactive. So the question is, how do we move to the proactive mode? And that's what Gail was really describing, getting these projections in place, getting all the spatial data in one place so we can pull it in at the same time and use those projections that the scientific community is providing to us to know which are the places that we really need to be building much more resilience for. And allow them to be those productive places, which areas can carry more of the human use loading, and which areas can't, and where we have to dial down our human activities. And that cumulative impact work helps us start making changes in different kinds of facilities and human activities and understanding how that reverberates through the coastal system. So, I mean, that's a long answer for you, and I would say there's no magic bullet that we found, but there are many different devices that we've been using on the land side that allow us to be a little bit more fluid than we're willing to admit.
That was a pretty thorough answer, but let me just add a tiny bit to it. Elliot's been talking about zoning for a long time, and he's talked right from the beginning about floating zones. So as we do zone for areas that are further and further from shore, we're dealing with top predator fish, those wonderful critters like tuna. But fortunately, we have scientists like Barbara Block and all of her many PhD students who are now tagging and tracking these large top predators. And we can actually see in quite dynamic, colorful models where they are at certain times of the year and where they're moving to. We can see how they track when they migrate across the Pacific. We can see them making a beeline for certain particular seamounts. So we already can identify some of the really critical areas that we know need to be protected, but we can also design zones that are floating at certain times of the year as we're able to track what's really happening with the fish. So this will be very dynamic over time. I'd say on land, we do, and we change all the time. We have these LAFCOs that say, okay, let's go and develop, let's move the urban boundary. Some of us would like not to have that happen. The thing we need to look at right now on land is particularly what little wetland and estuaries we have. are we protecting all the land upland of it? Because those estuaries are going to move. And if we're going to have wetlands and estuaries, we're going to need to allow for them to move. And so that's really important. I think it's going to be challenging.
I'd add one extra thing, which is from an implementation standpoint, you have to recognize that biology isn't perfectly predictable. And so when you place a marine protected area or some sort of zone, it can't be absolutely permanent. It has to be up for some sort of review process, and you have to evaluate whether or not what you have proposed is working over time. And that's a key component to actually making these networks function properly. You can't just set them in stone and then leave them alone and walk away.
We were discussing the impending agreement that's coming into effect next year regarding a management scheme to lower air emissions from seafaring vessels arriving at any port of entry on the U.S., the west coast of North America. And so the agreement is for reducing sulfur dioxide emissions simply through a change in fuel use on the international level, any ships that are entering North American seaports. So my question is, could you consider adding to the list air emissions as it directly relates to deposition to water and ocean acidification, and then also international agreements as strategies for implementing a lot of what you'd like to do in California?
Yeah, if I hadn't had an evil moderator, I would have gotten more into that. But the SOx and NOx emissions that you're referring to, they are controlled through our air districts. We have a Federal Clean Air Act. It's implemented by the states through their state implementation programs. Then that gets implemented on a regional level, and you have the South Coast Air Quality Management District doing that. And the cool thing about SOx and NOx emissions is that they tend to be shorter lived in the atmosphere. They tend to deposit more quickly than CO2. So the locals who are emitting those pollutants, whether it's a port or an energy facility or whatever, are then visiting the ramifications on their local communities. So there should be a confluence of interest there to control those emissions because of the impacts that they have on the very proximate coastal ecosystem. And I think the wonderful opportunity that we have, and US EPA is starting to set itself up for this, is to start to see our air districts and the Clean Air Act as really intimately related with ocean and coastal health, and have the air districts realize that they have a stewardship responsibility toward not only human beings who are breathing this stuff, but towards the coastal and ocean ecosystems as well. And we're actually moving very quickly in that direction. Did that answer your question?
Not quite, but that's okay.
I'll talk with you afterwards, too. Yeah.
So just one other thing, not on the air deposition, but just on the issue of international agreements and vessels, for instance, that travel throughout international waters. And I think it is one of the challenges. So on the water pollution side, the IMO is trying to phase in standards for treating ballast water discharges, but it's been a very slow process. And now the United States is out, at least some of the states are out pretty far ahead of IMO. It raises a lot of interesting issues about, ships that are coming in and out and what role the U.S. should play, in terms of leadership and in terms of trying to use those international mechanisms to try to push the rest of the world. I mean, in some sense, we've often used our sheer market power as a driver there. It's a challenge. I mean, I think you see it. There was some discussion earlier about ship strikes, and I think you see it there too, because our shipping lanes they're not just set by California or the Coast Guard. They're a whole negotiated thing with the international community. Again, we were involved in the blue whale ship strike stuff a few years ago off of the Channel Islands, and it was very hard to get the Coast Guard to move in the right direction because there were all these international obligations that they had to. So it is a big, I think it's a huge challenge. I think it's a huge opportunity there too if the United States steps up and takes some leadership.
I teach both international law and land use law, and I'm teaching them both at this point. And in the international side, we look at the regional seas and these kinds of problems. across the world. And a major focus there is coordination. And much of the result is very discouraging. At the local level, when we're talking about land use controls and regional controls, some of those models are very effective. Specific question, theoretically, because politically it would be very difficult, would some progress be made if we simply amended the Coastal Zone Act to increase its jurisdiction inland and to increase its jurisdiction into the territorial seas, focusing on the overall structure and the many successes it has had?
I'm not going to answer that question exactly, I don't think. But what I will say is that the Coastal Act itself actually does really extend the potential reach of the Coastal Commission well beyond the coastal zone by virtue of the consistency, federal consistency, for example, and also thinking, I think, more progressively about the California Environmental Quality Act and the implications of land use decisions, for example, that are made outside of the coastal zone that have very serious ramifications for resources and our you know, public trust assets within the coastal zone. So one of the things that we're trying to actually engineer and think about is how you can use CEQA and some of these systemic laws more effectively and give voice to cumulative impact review, for example, and apply the best science. So if we can ground truth those maps that Ben and Colin worked on, and really, they get to the point where they are scientifically peer-reviewed and credible for application in a land use permitting situation, for example, then I think we can start to give real meaning and teeth to cumulative impact analysis and to decision-making based on our understanding of how activities that are well outside the coastal zone really are affecting our public trust resources. So I think that what I'd really like to see is the Coastal Commission properly funded. I'd like to see it have the kind of resources that it needs to really, you know, discharge its duties as they're currently defined. That would be a dream come true.
I'd just like to second that last comment. The answer to your question is yes, theoretically yes, and politically it's not viable.
Hi, my name is Angela Ha. I'm the managing attorney with Surf Rider Foundation, and I think my question actually plays really well off what we just heard. Thank you all for your insightful presentations, and Gail is actually grabbed with your notion of anticipatory governance. And whereas I think the West Coast Governor's Agreement, because I'm on an action team and I'm familiar with them, I think they'll hand down a good mandate for cooperation, but where the rubber meets the road is really with the state agencies. And right now, the way they're set up is very reactionary. They permit projects. How can we make them more proactive in doing this anticipatory governance?
So I'll just start out just on that, and the others can jump in here, but I would say that, I mean, it's obviously a very salient point, and I would just say, so I'll let others answer the question, because there's been a lot of thinking going on, but we, you know, where we are in terms of renewables on land in California is at a point where we probably shouldn't be, which is we're reacting to every proposal out there, and it's a huge fight over whether this is the right place or not the right place. And if we had been prescient enough to try to do some planning for renewables 10 years ago, we might be farther down the line. So there is some, you know, lessons learned from there that maybe can be imported into the on the coastal side.
I think you've really put your finger on it, that the legal structure that we have right now, the framework that we've got in California, is not well suited for proactive planning. And that's in great contrast with how we manage our private lands and our public lands. Debbie and I actually analyzed that in, you know, one of our law review articles, and came to the conclusion that we have had opportunities in the past, like the LNG siting law, to actually engage in proactive planning, and we've seen that ultimately struck down for political reasons. So it's having the political will to understand that proactive planning might be in our best interests. And I should say that the experience that we're getting out of the solar facility siting in the desert really has resonated with a lot of legislators that I've talked to, and they really get it, that that's not a good way to go about making sure that we meet our renewable portfolio standard and our AB 32 obligations here in California. And they do understand that there's probably a much more sensible way to think about renewable siting. And so they understand the analogy there to some of the stuff that Gail was talking about. The question is whether or not we'll have the political will to really move towards more proactive decision making.
With that, may I ask you to join me in once more thanking all of our speakers.